Hey everyone, welcome to the channel. My name's Richard, and today we're going to cover the top 10 worst hit songs of 2023. I'm not much into intros for these kind of videos, as people tend just to want to dive right in, but as this is by far my biggest and most popular video of the year, I just want to quickly shout out a side series that I've been doing this year as well, where I've been ranking every Billboard year-end chart top 10. If you're looking for content with actual scores and grades and something a little more rapid fire than 40 minutes or so on a single year, if that's more your thing, feel free to go and show that series some love. Oh, and I also made and released like 6 albums as well, but you don't need to go listen to all those. Same rules as last year here, any song that charted in 2023 is eligible for the list, and anything that was on the year-end chart for 2023 as well. So, without any further ado, let's get going. The number 10 spot is fast becoming something I'm going to call the interesting disaster. A song that's a complete train wreck, but at least it gets a conversation going and is fun to write about. Previous winners of this goes to Dustin Lynch's Mama's House, where he gets dumped by a girl and swears to burn down an entire town before taking it back because he remembers his mother lives in said town. I'm very sad that no one remembers this. There was only one interesting disaster this year, and that of course was... I really wanted to be the voice that could defend this. I kept playing it over and over again, hoping it would win me over, but the more I played it, the more every little element just doesn't work. Its grand overture presentation and bass stabs that cut right through shows it wants to be theatrical and at points approach an industrial-like tone of hard-hitting, but it has no idea which idea will work best, so it just throws all of them at you at once in the hope that one of them will stick. And if the instrumentation is a confused mess, it just seeks to double down everywhere else as well, as Sam describes his whole sordid infidelity as they try their best to vamp up their voice to create a sleazy atmosphere. But as it's been pointed out elsewhere, they're the narrator of this story. They're just watching all of this rather than actually taking part in it, which just creates a disconnect in the song wanting to be so sexual and so provocative. And despite it aiming for grandeur, it's over before you know it. It's barely 2.5 minutes long. Intro, verse, chorus, done. I get why it's like this with modern trends the way they are. You want the chorus to be the sticky part that gets in everyone's head, go viral on the socials, etc. But it just feels like it's missing elements of a story to be explored further. Its heavily inspired musical-like presentation draws you in, but it can't commit to its premise. I really wanted this to work for Sam Smith's sake, for them trying something in a different direction than normal. And as for Kim, well, if Sam Smith does something this different again, I just hope it works out better. And as a final note, whenever I hear the line about the body shop, I just think of the UK retailer of the same name that specialises in skincare and fruit-based shower gel and soap. This song that wants to be so provocative, so sacrilegious, so scandalous, I'm just going to forever associate with the place I buy tea tree oil from and strawberry body wash. That's all.
Strongly advised me to not say what I want to say, I recently realized that they never said that I couldn't sing what I want to say, so.
I don't have the energy to tackle a Meghan Trainor comeback right now, so I'll see you in 2023's worst list if you become a hit. Well, I'm rested and hydrated. Let's get this over with.
I could have my Gucci on. I go in my Louis.
As much as it might be satisfying to see this make the top 10, in a strange way, I'm rooting for artists like Meghan Trainor, who's seemingly an easy punching bag for a lot of music communities to draw out the typical dismissive stan responses, such as who asked for this, why is she still here, we won't be listening, etc. I certainly didn't expect her to ever grace the Billboard charts ever again. She became a judge on a weird music contest show called The Four with P. Diddy and DJ Khaled, that led to a surreal moment with Rebecca Black.
Dude! Oh my god, I'm fangirling so hard! It's Rebecca Black! Do you know Rebecca Black?
What a very odd timeline we live in. Anyway, once you've taken up talent show contest duties, you've pretty much declared, yeah, I don't really care about chasing the Billboard grind anymore. But here we are, she's back. She's weaponized TikTok, and it's just the same old trainer brand doo-wop we had like 7 years ago. That's not to say I don't like doo-wop, but it's Megan's particular style that's always rubbed me up the wrong way, that's always felt so synthetic and overproduced. If you look at something like The Five Satins in the Still of the Night from 1956. Obviously different time, different recording techniques and all that, but it's as if nothing has changed. With all the different directions she could have taken after all this time, Megan just dropped the equivalent of a dank goofy meme. I just think it's more frustrating than anything. I don't think Megan is untalented. No is a good chorus away from being a legitimately great song. And those 8 people in the world who you were told that liked her duet with John Legend? Hi, I'm one of them. I even gave her new album a chance when it dropped last year. Well, I got 3 songs in before she hit me with this.
See, I don't know what they're playing on the radio, but if it ain't that old school, it ain't got no soul.
And then I went back to the 2 better records that were released on the same day as her. But what's more frustrating than anything is I see the potential here from what actually inspired this song.
And that's because I always struggle with my body, but then I had a C-section with stretch marks with the baby. It was extra.
As someone who's friends with people who've had C-sections and experienced postnatal depressions, songs that make you feel good about yourself in this day and age shouldn't be dismissed, or have their importance of them denied. Megan probably would have been aware of the polarizing reception that All About That Bass had all those years ago, and you'd have hoped she'd have learnt lessons into how to frame her feelings better and come out with something that would have been more impactful. But, yeah, we're still doing the same thing as ever. Oh well.
It's kind of like when you go to like a family gathering, you know, and there's a weird aunt there who keeps coming up to you and going like, "Hey girl, what's the tea?" And you're like, ugh.
Sometimes, it's not just about being a bad song. It's about wasted potential. I'm certainly not opposed to couples having songs with each other. There's plenty of occasions where it's worked pretty well, and, you know, a whole lot where it hasn't, and that's aged like milk. It should bring about a higher amount of chemistry and intimacy that could make a song better than if the duet in question isn't a real-life couple. But in reality here, there's a fifth wheel involved.
Hand on the Bible, don't know how I got you, but I couldn't ask for more. Girl, what we got's worth thanking God for.
Look, if you find that a higher power gives you the strength, all the power to you, but I'm pretty sure the big man upstairs had nothing to do with you being incapable of feeling loved, Kane. Maybe if you tried leaving him out of this weird threesome you got going on here, you could make some room for some actual chemistry with your wife. If the song's presentation wasn't so clear and it wasn't made so obvious both singers are married, you would not be able to tell. There's no warmth to this utterly mechanical instrumentation, no passion in either delivery, and worst of all, it's in a minor key. Even Dan and Shay got this right.
Cause every high and every low leads to this. I'm just so glad you exist. Ooh, ooh.
See, Dan and Shay are happy and glad that you exist, and actually sound happy about it. These two... yeah, thank God I get to wake up next to you. It just completely messes with the tone and message the whole song is going for. If it was a happier sounding song, it probably still would have been corny as hell, but at least I would have believed that these two are actually husband and wife. What a waste. Next.
I can already hear the comments on this video. She's gaslighting, manipulating. Oh, she's a narcissist and a rat. I would never make a mistake like that.
So this comment was left on my video for 2022, and I just want to take a moment to personally say thank you to the person who wrote this. If you're watching this right now, please know stuff like this means a lot to me. And I'd like to think me taking the time to gently talk about Walker Hayes show what direction my style of criticism takes. Something which is heavily inspired by Folding Ideas, whose calm yet utterly brutal 40-plus minute takedown of Dog Walkers the Wall is one of my very favourite videos on this platform.
I'm going to have to say a bunch of unkind things, and there's really no way around that.
All of this is to say, I'm afraid I'm going to have to disappoint you in particular here. Because Jesus Christ, what the hell does anyone see in Oliver Tree?
Don't remind me, I'm minding my own damn business.
Probably a surprise pick here. It barely charted for a week, but I heard it get enough radio play after that, so people out there must have heard this one in some way. So I think it's fair game. Look, there are many popular artists and bands out there who you can listen to and think, yeah, I get the appeal, but I just don't think it's for me. Think, I don't know, Death Grips, Swans, 100 Gex. But Oliver Tree, I just don't get either way. I see songs of his that have over 300 million views on YouTube, and yeah, I've got nothing. Feel free to tell me what his appeal is below. Is it the narcissism, the sarcasm, the irony, the postmodern irony, the memes? Am I thinking about this all way too much? I just don't get it. I just see a shape-shifting figure of a man willing to pull whatever move necessary to get attention. Look at my funny clothes and weird videos. Aren't I funny? Aren't you laughing? Look, I randomly started yelling at Fantano for no reason. What a wacky character I am.
I don't fuck with you, Fantano. I don't fuck with anyone who tries to cross you when they're trying to be
okay,
a promotional.
Okay, all right.
Let's just say this.
But never mind that. We're totally fine again.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, I mean, you know, the beef, the argument, that happened. It's water under the bridge.
Did you not like that beef? Well, I started another one with KSI. Psych, we're totally fine too. And look, we made a song together. Oh, you didn't like it? Oh, well, here I am with Belle Delphine. Ha! Gamer girl bathwater, am I right? Memes. Is any of this funny to you? Please like me, I'm desperate for your love, and I'm nothing without your attention. Oh yeah, there's a song here too. It's a generic house track that barely sounds finished. It's almost like it was dubiously put together from another song that's better than this one. This version, however, starts and ends in first gear, with little variety to starve off the headache you're going to receive from Oliver's vocal delivery that sounds like he's drunk,
pinching his own nose,
and has a bad head cold. And on a final unrelated note, in trying to research this song's creation, I ended up down a rabbit hole where I found out that these two once dated.
Daggers made from your perfect past and stab me repeatedly in my bony little back.
2023 was just lacking songs that were bad for uncomplicated reasons, and even when they arrived, they tended not to stick around. But I won't let this one be forgotten.
Slut me out, slut me out, slut, slut, slut.
Fewer things charting in 2023 gave me as much entertainment as Enerly Chopper trying to come across as the man having all of the sex, trying to be the domineering king of masculine energy, who's listened to all of the alpha male podcasts.
I don't care what you have a PhD in. If you cannot physically overpower me, you cannot tell me what to do.
Yet repeatedly saying slut me out as if he's being pimped out himself.
Big dick energy, I give it. Don't...
Of course you do, sweetie.
Gonna put this here in your kidney, please.
Not to give you advice here, you magnificent sex-having king of sex, but you might want to try putting it somewhere else.
Why you being weird to me?
It's because you're trying to fuck her kidneys, my dude. Sir, this is a Wendy's, and you have completely ruined this hummus dip of mine. Promise that my nut tastes like sugar gravy. How do you know? And if somehow you're not completely grossed out by all of this, well, fear not. Mr. Chopper has got you covered. With a clean version. Slow me out, slow me out, slow, slow, slow me out. Perfection. Just, chef's kiss. I needed this in this year, in all years. Thank you, Enerly Chopper.
I'm sure you're disappointed in my shitty little song.
Hey, remember this one? No? Look, I'm not saying I had high hopes for a song called Shut Up, My Mum's Calling, but Jesus Christ, this version of We Have Tame Impala at Home is horrendous. Oh yeah, falling in reverse charge this year, didn't they? Look, if I'm going to continue discussing music on the internet, I'm just going to have to accept that Ronnie Radke is eventually going to threaten me with violence at one point. Because I dare say something so out of line such as this hilarious genre clusterfuck of Drake, Eminem, and, I don't know, insert whatever generic metalcore star you can think of here. And it all turns out to be not very good. So we may as well just get it out the way with now. I'm just part of your mission to fight everyone in the universe, Ronald. It's almost like your life is like a video game. This song isn't even that bad, but when you have Metro Boomin, 21 Savage, and The Weeknd on a track together, and the best they can come up with is a cover slash interpolation slash slow version of an R&B cut from the 2000s by Mario, don't you think it's time you wanted more than just fine, and more than just good enough? Spoiler alert, this song is also going to be on the best list as well. It's here because, well, you know, it's called Waffle House. Is the music industry just setting itself up for some food and drink-based alliances? Like it's Game of Thrones or something? Walker Hayes has Applebee's, Kanye West has Chick-fil-A, Cardi B and Offset have McDonald's, Brantley Gilbert has Bud Light. Yeah. Ah, wait, no, hang on. Brantley Gilbert has whatever the hell this thing is. Sorry, I've gotten off track and lost where I was going with this. Fuck Brantley Gilbert? Yeah, sure, that'll do. Next. This kind of fell awkwardly between years, to the point I don't really know what to do with it, but I would not forgive myself if I didn't make a point in this video to stop and say, fuck you for sampling Daft Punk, and a much bigger fuck you for the Megan Thee Stallion lines relating to the Tory Lanez case. Fuck all the way off, and when you've gotten to the point where you fucked off too, feel free to fuck off a bit further. Couple billion in the world, baby, you're the only girl in mind. I've honestly forgotten how the song even sounds until I started editing this video. I've thought so little about this song that I'm pretty sure I'm just putting it here because the name Parmalee is attached to it. Oh, I love it and I hate it at the same time.
You and I drink the poison from the same vine. I didn't care for a Diet Hosier sing a Wish.com version of Take Me to Church. 4 out of 10. Not gay enough. More gay needed. God gave me a girl,
girl gave me a kiss, kiss. No. If this had charted in any kind of way, I would have put it straight to number 1. Maybe there's a separate video for songs just as bad as this that didn't chart this year, coming soon on this channel. Maybe you'd like to hit the bell and be notified when I upload that. Hint, hint. Bat eyelashes, etc. Ugh, hang on one sec. And lastly, the Chris Brown section of this video. Thank you, that was the Chris Brown section of the video.
Reputation's deceased.
Worthless tend to go one of two ways. To calmly explain why something doesn't work for you, or just yell at some garbage for a minute. And as I said before, while I prefer the former because I've never been an angry YouTuber of sorts, if any song was going to make me become one, it would be something like this.
Hey yo, y'all seen this little marble kid?
And for the record, I do mean a minute. I'm not even going to play you any audio besides the last line. I just value you as a viewer, and I don't want you to leave. Let's get this one over with quick, and let's be positive about this one. 2023 was widely considered a bad year for the charts, but hey, look on the bright side. We could have given this more than 3 weeks worth of charting success. A song where he tells you he's 100% independent. A quick Google search there says otherwise. Tells you that mixing two colours together makes another one. Good to know his IQ matches his educational level. And then makes a blowjob reference about a fashion designer who died tragically young from cancer. If you haven't heard this song before, I want you to imagine how any of this sounds. And then trust me when I say it's 10 times worse than what you're thinking it does. All of this and more that begged for a reaction, begged for attention, begged for success, and apart from randomly jumping up 40 places 1 week and then disappearing the next.
Totally nothing weird about that.
In 2023 of all years, something like this would have been successful. But instead, everyone collectively said,
no.
Everyone give yourself a round of applause. Here's that last line and a SpongeBob reaction clip.
I can't take a break till my boo is a household name.
I'm busy planning to rule the world!
Well, good luck with that.
Have I made some jokes in poor taste? Yes. Have I made lots of dumb mistakes? Yes.
I'm good, yeah, I'm feeling alright, baby.
So I wrote I'm Good Off as a joke last year. Bebe Rexha is the equivalent of a stock photo of a singer with so little personality that she literally had an AI-generated music video come out this year. Oh, and David Guetta's being kept alive by memes.
In honour of George Floyd, shout out to his family.
So as the synths blared and Bebe Rexha yelled about having the best fucking night of her life, I felt nothing but numb. And while I have way too much kind nostalgia for Blue by Eiffel 65, actually if I'm going to have a terrible opinion, Blue by Eiffel 65 is great, I love it, but I kind of just dismissed the whole thing without a second thought, just as being a one-off. That surely wouldn't happen again. Right? Right? At the very least, I can kind of get what I'm Good is doing. If you remove it from the YouTube critic scene who placed it onto all of the worst lists, it's a blaring throwback of sorts, the sound of the club boom era. Play it in the club while everyone's drinking and dancing, it's going to breeze past, and probably not be thought of after the next song is put on by the DJ. But this? No, this is a completely different beast. Okay, let's take a look at the original by Hadaway for starters.
What is love? Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more. Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more.
The synth and analog work is cold in its production here. Quite simplistic in its execution, there's not a lot of reverb or sparkle to the sound, and this is intentional to match the ambiguous nature of the lyrics. Question after question, thought after thought, what is love? And then the female vocal just blows right past it all with a melisma. Seemingly not caring, either lost in their own nature or not having a response at all. And also because the melisma is a sample and not an actual vocalist. I totally didn't know that. It's mysterious in its elements, and now I've said all that, maybe you think about it differently and see it another way. You're probably not, because you're not a total dork like me, you're just going to go crazy in the club when it comes on like everyone else. So the new version. Both singers have just been given the same notes here, which is the sample comes first, so I don't know, just be horny for a single verse. It's not that there's no subtlety or nuance or really any kind of coherent story arc or chemistry between them, It's just that the sample is the glue and duct tape that holds it all together. It's creatively bankrupt in that it's just doing the exact same thing that a whole lot of other songs have done the past few years. Take an incredibly obvious sample, cash in on the nostalgia, easy money. And I say this as someone who actually likes Players by Coi Leray, because she's doing something interesting there with the sample itself. But here, hey everyone, look, we're doing the head dance thing from that movie. Pay us to remind you of that head dance thing from the movie. And like with I'm Good, it's the exact same thing here, just a brick wall of blaring synth work with no variety, no sense of dynamic diversity or development. And then 2 minutes and 20 seconds later, it ends. No, I'm serious, they spend 30 seconds of the rest of the official video runtime running through the credits. Because, you know, I'm sure you were just dying to know who did Coi Leray and Anne-Marie's makeup and hair on the day. An empty, soulless husk of a song. Next.
The only thing I've ever groomed is my two Persian cats. I'm not a groomer. I'm just a loser.
Yeah, that's my intro. Just a sigh. I am as sick of this as you are.
I need someone to be patient with me. Someone to get money when I take it from me.
Between the muted reception and failure to go to number one, everything about this just reeks of failure and a waste of everyone's time. It's not even on the album that came out this year, and that already tells you everything you need to know. And that is that Drake is back, everyone, with a new song. I mean, he still had several songs from the last album, he only released 6 months before this one, but Drake is back. He never left in the first place, but because you didn't talk about him for 5 minutes, oh, he gets very upset. It's not every single thought in every single waking moment that you possibly have. And he is back with another comatose-inducing banger. Because it's not just every single waking moment that you have to dedicate to Drake, it's every single dream as well. Even by Drake standards, this redefines lazy. It's not even half-assed, more like quarter-assed. All of the possible budget in the world to make something well-produced, and all of the time in the world, because people would immediately flock to a new Drake single regardless of how long you've been away for. And this is your best possible next foot forward.
You don't know how to express my love, that's why American Express.
I'm starting to think quarter arsed is too generous, like 16th arsed or something, I don't know, mass was never my strongest subject. So Drake has nothing new to say, nothing new there. What could he possibly do to ensure you pay all the attention to him?
I didn't come this far just to come this far and not be happy.
Okay.
Remember that.
You didn't come this far just to come this far.
Yep. I saw it on the internet.
That's right. Completely unnecessary drama. After seemingly squashing any kind of beef he had with Kanye, here he is, back on his bullshit to start trouble all over again, literally stopping the song dead in its tracks for no apparent reason, just to bring full attention to it. I mean, who on earth does that? Who just stops what they're doing randomly to change to something else for no apparent... The answer is Drake does that, because that'll get the gossip columns talking, that'll get the drama alert channels going off. Why? Because fuck you, that's why. Because look at me everyone, I'm Drake and I can. What does Kanye West think of all this? What does Kim think of all this? What's your opinion? Remember to spread it like wildfire on Twitter, because having attention is better than producing something of actual quality. That's where we are now. It's not about music, it's about doing whatever it takes to get people to notice you. Well, I did. So I guess I'm to blame here too. Congratulations, Drake. Hope it was worth it.
Mistake doesn't make them a terrible human. It just makes them a human.
So by my own rules, any Morgan Wallen song can go here. and I've thought long and hard about which one it will be. And then I thought, well, Morgan Wallen has presented us with a 36-song buffet. Why not hand him 36 plates, and he can take the entire spot himself?
Last night we let the liquor talk. I can't remember everything we said, but we said it all.
No, I'm not kidding. Morgan Wallen owns the entirety of the number 2 spot. You might think that's over the top, and maybe I'm just doing it to make up for the fact that I didn't put Broadway Girls on my list last year. It's absolutely for that reason. Why the hell did I not put Broadway Girls on my list last year? Wait, don't ask me, I have no idea. It's also not because of the free pass he seems to have into still being relevant, despite, you know. I've liked several Morgan Wallen songs before One Thing at a Time decided it would turn itself into 36 different things at a time over the length of time of an average Hollywood-produced movie. More Than My Hometown and Seven Summers are both great songs. Sand in My Boots was actually on my best list last year, where I felt like just mentioning his name meant that I had to jump behind heavily fortified castle walls and make offhand jokes about avoiding the conversation.
What's that? I can't hear you. I appear to be running away from the Morgan Wallen discourse that you'll never catch.
And go off into extended paragraphs about separating the art from the artist, as if just liking a Morgan Wallen song is a crime. But in 2023, if you're a bankable musician and you're still making money reliably to the point your record label still wants you, you're going to be fine. And dropping a 36-song album means you only have one thing in mind. Stream trolling. The act of releasing all of the music with no kind of coherent arc or reason. Like, no artist wakes up in the morning and says, you know what I'm going to do today? Start work on a 36-song album. Unless you're a video game composer and have to write a soundtrack with this many songs, or a veteran band compiling a greatest hits record, or someone whose name I don't want to mention in this video more than twice, or, I don't know, an avant-garde prog rock band making a concept record, no album should be 36 songs long.
What about your new album? Does it have too many songs as well?
It has way too many songs, yeah.
How many songs does it have?
36.
You have 36 songs on your new album?
I do, yeah.
You're never going to hear the end of it. At least we won't.
I think most people won't.
And yeah, there's no coherency in storytelling or an arc, and they just paint a picture of a man half battling his demons and half enjoying hanging out with them. If you ain't gonna kiss me, then I'll take some whiskeys. Can't go nowhere near the whiskey, cause you used to drink it with me, and I bet on my truck. If it's water, if it's whiskey in my cup. It's just me, Jack and Jim, won't you play a little Whitley for me and my.
Congratulations, Morgan. You have successfully made me never want to drink any of this ever again.
If I was seeing it from his point and trying to be kind, it's the sound of a man who doesn't know what you want from him, so he's trying to please everyone. From bleeding his soul out for the world to hear, thinking he's so far gone he shouldn't be forgiven. To a confessional moment of heartbreak to his mother. And to whatever the hell this is. Actually, I think I like this one, but then again, this is also 31 songs into the album itself, and part of me maybe just feels sorry for him at this point. He's thrown everything possible at you, and yeah, there are good songs on this album, but music should not make you feel like a pirate searching for the sweet buried treasure of album deep cuts. Side note, one of these songs is actually making my best list, so good luck guessing which one that is. But more than anything, an hour and 53 minutes worth of Morgan Wallen just leads me to another big question. Where are we going right now? We're 3 years into the 2020s now, and granted I'm willing to let that first year slide for obvious reasons, but I think that's still enough time to ask, what's the next defining trend in this decade going to be? Like a club boom, or bro country, or the crunk era? Because so far, there's lots of ideas everywhere which I'm genuinely excited and interested in, but no clear frontrunner. I thought the disco nostalgia was really going to embrace the era, but then fizzled out with a whimper, mainly owing to one of its main sources. Let's not go there, shall we? Pop music is scattered as always. It comes and goes, but it's always present in some way. Country seems to have a more traditional focus than ever, and it's more simple from a presentation standpoint. And I really love that. But I wonder if that just begins and ends with Zach Bryan. Same thing with the regional Mexican scene that's exploded into popularity this year, led by Peso Pluma and Grupo Frontero. Only time will tell on that front. Reggaeton is here, same defined drum pattern as always, and I really hope I can connect with a song from the genre and take my first incredibly awkward steps into attempting to talk about it. Hip-hop is ever-present, but it has its own comfort zone and favourite artists. Doja Cat and Ice Spice have broken through, but there's not an artist who's broken through on a Drake-like level of popularity. It's like that for most genres in that aspect. I look at the charts sometimes and ask myself, okay, who's the next big star? What's the next big trend? And I don't really have an answer. And that kind of bothers me. I know the level of Billboard's quality wildly varies from year to year, and at the end of the day, the charts can be easily manipulated by the forces in charge and even the artists themselves. And ultimately, in the grand scheme of things, yeah, it really doesn't matter. I guess I just want something fresh and exciting just to shake things up, make things different. I don't even care if the magical new thing comes along and I don't even like it at this point. If not for myself, but to make a more interesting list for you, the watcher. Like, how many times are you going to see Search and Rescue on Worst List this year? You've been seeing Drake on Worst List for years and years at this point. But then, you know, Drake made a bad song, so here I go putting him on here again. And like Drake, I don't want the next big trend to just become a dick measuring contest into who can have the biggest album, who can have the most tracks to chart, and who can have all of the chart records. Because in the end, that's what this is here. And to answer my own question on who's the next big star, who's going to be big this decade? Well, 1 week this year, over a third of the Hot 100 belonged to this man. A man who has made so much of the discourse this year, just from the sheer volume of it all, utterly exhausting.
What do I know?
You already know what's going to be here. Anyone who makes a top 10 worst list in 2023 will have this right at the top, and your favourites who make year-end worst lists are dreading talking about it. An utterly misguided and ill-conceived disaster from top to bottom, as a result of either being surrounded by a bunch of yes-men, or as a result of no one around them with a working brain stopping them to just say no.
Fuck me, right?
Nah, but seriously though, fuck Jason Aldean. Okay, there are two ways in which we might tackle this, so let's do the first. Try That in a Small Town is the worst hit song of 2023. Thank you so much for watching. Remember to like and subscribe, and take care.
If trouble comes a-looking, he won't be hard to find. He's sitting in the hotel bar on his second glass of wine.
No, I'm serious. End of video. We're done here. Go watch Crow's Best of Video, go watch Lizette's latest subscriber special, or Mark and Grady's reviews on country music to find stuff that's actually good. Okay, that's the first way to tackle this done. If you're still here, well, I guess you really want to stick around for an over-elaborate, overly researched takedown of this godforsaken song. Well, I wouldn't be doing my job if I denied you of that, would I? Let's do the second way. Although I was happy enough ignoring this song months after it came out, I'd seen the lyrics a dozen or so times every time I'd opened Twitter. People were mocking it for sure, but it wasn't going any further than that. Because Jason Aldean's music is itself easy to ignore, and even harder to remember. The two songs of his I can actually properly remember after this one are Don't You Wanna Stay, only because Kelly Clarkson completely outperforms him to the point she just embarrasses him. Oh, and Dirt Road Anthem, because he attempts to rap and just embarrasses himself.
In all this small town, he said, she said, ain't it funny how rumors spread like I know something y'all don't know? Man, that talk is getting old. You better mind your business, man. Watch your mouth before I have to knock that loud mouth out.
And so the song was put to one side. His promo team had left him after the transphobic comments his wife made last year, so weren't around to help him out. And country radio obviously wanted none of the fire this would create. And so it was left to the internet to grab some petrol and a match. And for all the content creators, chart followers and reaction-style channels who jumped on this rather than just let it fade, I get it. The charts this year have been a relatively dead zone of activity for about half of the year, with three songs in particular engaged in the world's slowest game of musical chairs. If the guy who cheated on his wife and then wrote a song about how great of a decision it was to cheat on his wife, and who did blackface followed by a sorry you feel that way about me doing said blackface, is finally going to have his full mask off moment, I can't blame you. Go get your clicks, go get your easy dunk. Hell, it's what I'm doing right now and what will be my most popular video of the year views-wise. Granted, Adeen the artist has us all beat on this occasion.
Now it's true that I am ignorant on most of this. A couple folks for some reason called me a bigot. But I sweat a lot and I sing them loud. Even though I didn't write the shit I'm singing about.
But as for the song itself, from a sonic standpoint at least, it's just like every other Jason Aldean song I can't remember. Same generic mush that can't fully commit to a brand of pop or bro country. Hell, it's more 2000s era butt rock than anything. But there's no satisfying smolder or menace. It comes across more spoken word than actually sung at points, and just a sneering mule with all the presence of someone who's hiding behind a fake name on Reddit. Filled with all the contempt and bravado that embodies the character Bo Burnham was mocking when he made Pandering.
I walk and talk like a field hand, but the boots I'm wearing cost $3,000. I write songs about rotten tractors from the comfort of a private jet.
You could say this because the song has four songwriters, none of which are Jason, and wait a minute, that name sounds familiar. Hang on. So these two songs are co-written by the same person. I think that says a lot. I don't normally harp on about the number of songwriters or if the artist in question even wrote it themselves, because music is largely a collaborative medium and many hands make for light work and all that. But when you make a song like this, it makes the entire scenario around it far worse. These aren't even Jason's words. It's an artistically bankrupt and cowardly thing to do. Granted, his previous few records underperformed, and maybe this was just a way to drum up attention again, by any means necessary. Because he knows the kind of audience he has amassed over the years, who will see the controversy, watch Fox News, or see him complain about cancel culture at his live shows. The kind of audience that will then rush to iTunes to buy the song, claim they're owning the libs or whatever. And yeah, this song got some streaming, but let's face it, this was a game to them. They saw the outrage, the backlash, and responded accordingly. And so it went to number one. His first ever Billboard number one. And it's a case where all of the discourse and backlash around it plays the biggest role. Every part, of course, he denies, plays ignorant. Did Jason mean it all along? Is he just playing ignorant for all the cameras? Why is his guitarist playing one of the most recognizable riffs in history? None of it really matters as he meekly delivers the line, "Try that in a small town. See how far you make it down the road."
Yeah, we all wear boots and we love to shoot and we root for the cops to stop people like you. This is a sundown town. Oh, baby, it's a sundown town.
But this is his peak regardless. The mask-off moment for many people has truly happened. I mean, performing in front of the Maury County Courthouse with the history that place has, with lyrics like these, will do that. So where does he go from here? The Aaron Lewis route? scream what the fuck at his TV and complain about Bruce Springsteen? Well, as someone who grew up in a small town myself, rather than somewhere with a general population of 150,000, there's a Springsteen song for this occasion. That, funnily enough, he was actually halfway towards getting the sentiment right. Or as I previously said, his last few records underperformed to his standards. People were moving on before this took off, and he needed something to get people talking and reacting again. You know somebody else who drastically changed his style from utterly generic to political for the same reason? Because I do.
Give me a jacket at smoke hole. Give me a jacket at smoke. Give me a jacket at smoke hole.
My people love this country and we're under attack. They banning us, they cancel us for speaking the facts. If you man enough, come stand with us, take USA back.
Well, your rapping does need working on, Jason. And with that terrible thought, once again, try that in a small town. The worst hit song of 2023. And that's the list. Thank you so much for watching. If you'd like to like and subscribe, it would be a wonderful help to the channel. Leave comments about anything you'd like below, because that will help the algorithm. And I'd love to know what your top 10 lists are as well. And lastly, I've set myself up a Patreon. For just £2 a month, if you want to help support the channel further moving forward, the link is in the description box below. Thank you so much again for watching. I'll see you next time for the best list. Take care.